Please join us in singing hymn number 92, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Thank you. You may be seated. As the sons of Korah declare, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. God will be exalted among the nations. God will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Please pray with me. Our God, our mighty fortress, we come before you with hearts full of thanksgiving for this moment. By your grace and your kind providence, tonight we celebrate with these our graduates and with their families and friends. May this be a sweet time for our graduates. We pray now that you would bless their lives with faithfulness and fruitfulness. May all that we do this evening bring honor and glory to your holy name and the name of your Son, our Savior, we pray. Amen. On behalf of the Board of Directors, the faculty, the staff, I welcome you, honored friends, family members, and all of you joining us via live stream. And I especially welcome you, our graduates. Many of you are joining us in person, and many of you are joining us in live stream. And I want to say to you, first and foremost, congratulations, class of 2021. You really should be clapping for them because they are a great-looking bunch, aren't they, as they came down here? Especially in those robes. I often say any friend of Batman's is a friend of mine. It has been quite a year for you graduates. And as we reflect on this year and your time here, I would simply point you to our name. Our name serves us well in times of plenty and in times of want, in pre-pandemic times and in pandemic times. You know our last name, the part about college. These faculty have put you through your paces. Beneath those smiles are some tired faces and tired bodies. We are a college. You know our first name. It's not only the Reformation solas, it's not only the theology, it's also the boldness, the courage of the reformers. Today, and as you leave here, and as the decades unfold, what is needed is not just confession, but what is needed is conviction. But then there's our middle name. For many of you graduates, I'm seeing your middle name for the first time. There it is in the program for all of the world to see. And you know our middle name. As Paul told Timothy, you have been acquainted with the sacred writings. May they be your constant companion in life. They have never failed you, and they never will. Well, our graduates come from places. 22 states are represented among our graduating class. We have two from Canada and one from Honduras. And what's more, she's here. And not only is she here, she brought her whole family with her from Honduras. This year, we are graduating for our first time, our inaugural online foundation year program students. Some of you are with us in person. Many of you are graduating in the comforts of your home and joining us online. All of you are pioneers. Our graduates come from many places, and they are going many places. Several will be going to seminary. Several will remain in or return to serving in their local church. Two of you are getting married, and you're getting married to each other. I love this line that I heard today. Not only did RBC give me a great education, but it also gave me a husband. Now, that's not a promise our admissions department can make, but when we come good on it, aren't we all glad? Well, that young lady's parents are here, and I'd like to tell them directly, thank you for sending us three of your children. And so my question to you is, do you have any more? Two of our graduates will go on to pursue a nursing degree. One of you is already talking with editors at Crossway about a potential book. Three of you will be working full-time at Ligonier Ministries. So you are welcome, Mr. Larson, for those employees. And one of you is going all of the way to Africa to serve with Rafiki in Liberia. Well, to all of you graduates, I will paraphrase what our friend, Dr. Sinclair Ferguson, told my graduating class at Westminster Seminary. Remember this: once an RBC man or woman, always an RBC man or woman. Our speaker is Dr. Jonathan Master. He's the newly minted president of Greenville Presbyterian Theological Seminary in Greenville, South Carolina. He holds a bachelor's degree from Cairn University, an MDiv and a THM from Capital Bible Seminary, and a PhD from Aberdeen. I am surrounded by Aberdeen and Edinburgh, and here I am with my plain black Presbyterian Scottish robe from Westminster Seminary. Dr. Master has previously served in pastorates and has served in undergraduate education. He's the author of A Question of Consensus, The Doctrine of Assurance After the Westminster Confession, and author of the recently published Growing in Grace. He's editor of The God We Worship. He's co-editor of On Reforming Worship. He's the co-host of the podcast Theology on the Go. He's married to Elizabeth. They have two daughters and two dogs. Dr. Master, welcome to RBC. We look forward to hearing your address and your ministry to us from the Word. First, Dr. Dudrick.
Hear the word of the Lord through his servant Paul, as he wrote in Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 through 6. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person.
Members of the Board of Directors, President Nichols, professors, family members and friends, and students of the class of 2021. It is such a great privilege and an honor for me to speak to you on this occasion. What a joy to share this special day with you. There's nothing quite like a college graduation ceremony, and especially one at an institution such as this, which places a high value on deep study of the scriptures and combines this with an abiding interest in the best of our philosophical and literary heritage. I've spent a number of my vocational years in higher education, and I can tell you that what you have received here is extraordinary. You are to be commended for seeking out this kind of education, and you deserve special recognition on this day for having completed your rigorous course of study. Russell Kirk often referred to intellectual formation as the furnishing of the mind, and here your mind has been furnished well, giving you the opportunity to live and flourish and to serve the Lord with all your being, as we're commanded to do. As we all know, this has been a singular year in the life of our nation. I'm fairly certain that for those of you who are graduating seniors, you had no idea in the fall of your junior year that these last semesters would proceed the way they have. Even our most sophisticated and wise cultural commentators wouldn't have imagined all the most significant events that have transpired in the last 12 months. For some, it's even hard to remember what normal life was like just a few years ago, and many institutions, not least institutions of higher learning, are struggling to understand how to find their way back. In light of this changing and unpredictable landscape, we would do well to heed the words of the Apostle Paul in Colossians 4, 5, and 6, which were just read to us. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of your time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer every person. This is no small task, but walking in wisdom and speaking graciously seem to always go hand in hand in the Bible. Among the many topics covered in that great repository of wisdom called the Book of Proverbs, no topic receives more attention than speech. It receives greater attention than money, than conflict, than marriage, than relationships and work. It is our words that are tied most closely with wise living in this world. Walking wisely and speaking well are a special challenge when the culture in which we live is so opposed to biblical teaching. We know instinctively in our daily lives that speaking about certain subjects will get us into trouble. We know that if we speak about eternal conscious punishment in hell, that's unpalatable to many in our corner of the world and our moment in time. We understand that biblical teaching about marriage and sexuality cuts against the grain of our culture today, making us, in many cases, nothing short of pariahs in the eyes of the world. At an intellectual level, I think one of the most helpful treatments of what we are dealing with has been recently done by the eminent philosopher Edward Fazer. He identifies the animating philosophical lies in our time as being a kind of new Gnosticism. Gnosticism, both in the first centuries of the church and today, begins, of course, as you know, with a lie about creation. Fazer writes, "The Gnostic mentality is one of radical alienation from the created order. It sees that order as something to be destroyed or escaped from rather than redeemed." But the goodness of creation is repeatedly affirmed in the Bible. When Paul refutes false teaching, he explicitly says that such false teaching is based on a misapprehension of creation. You remember the words of the New Testament, "For everything created by God is good and is to be received with thanksgiving." This is true of food, of marriage, of the creation of male and female in God's image. Of course, Gnosticism does not stop with the rejection of creation. It also creates an alternate understanding of revelation. Again, quoting from Fazer, he says, "It holds that the truth cannot be known from the appearance of things or from any official sources, but has been passed along under the radar and is accessible only to the initiated." The Gnostic epistemology, Fazer writes, is what today would be called a hermeneutics of suspicion. Fazer goes on to state, therefore, that the Gnostic mindset sees reality in starkly Manichaean terms, as a twilight struggle between the sinister forces that rule this evil world and those who have been purified of it and armed with gnosis. He goes on to liken this to a word that we hear much in our discourse today, the word woke. Therefore, he continues, "The Gnostic mindset is not interested in common ground or tolerance of differences." Now, the temptation in the midst of this is to respond in kind. But that option is not open to us if we are to heed the teaching of the New Testament. In addition to the words that we heard from Colossians, Paul also commands this in his letter to the Ephesians. "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Needless to say, this kind of wise living and gracious speech is difficult in an environment such as ours. But it will serve as a marker, setting us apart as pilgrims and strangers, aliens and exiles. It shows the world that our citizenship is in heaven, from which we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We have a great cloud of witnesses behind us. There are countless biblical examples of those who walked with wisdom toward outsiders and spoke with grace in the midst of very hostile cultural circumstances. Several such examples are found in the book of Daniel. The book begins with one of the great tragedies in the history of Israel, the destruction of Jerusalem and of the temple by Nebuchadnezzar. However much we may feel that the culture of our day is against us, in Daniel's day, an idolatrous king destroyed the holy city of Jerusalem, removed the sacred items from the temple of the Lord in order to place them in pagan temples, and took all of the most promising young men of Judah so that they could be re-educated in Babylon and put in service to that pagan empire. How do you walk in wisdom in the midst of those kinds of outsiders? Well, in the case of Daniel and the other young believers, we see different strategies employed in different circumstances. As far as we can tell, most of their walk of wisdom took the form of what James Davison Hunter calls faithful presence. In other words, they worked humbly and consistently within the confines of the existing structures of the society of which they were a part, living wisely and speaking graciously. Daniel, we might recall, was made ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief prefect over all the wise men of Babylon. In all these circumstances, Daniel and his friends are presented to us as prototypical wise men, speaking and acting graciously in the midst of outsiders. By functioning in this capacity as a faithful presence in a secular world, these men were simply following in the footsteps of many earlier and later biblical examples. Joseph served in Potiphar's house and then as the second in command to Pharaoh. After them, men like Ezra and Nehemiah also held prominent roles in the pagan kingdoms of their day. Your education, steeped as it has been in the Holy Scriptures and in the best of what has been written and said in the history of our culture, has prepared you well to serve as a faithful presence in this way. It may well be that walking with wisdom toward outsiders will, for you, involve navigating the halls of business and government, finance, law, medicine, or academia, or any number of other challenging and rigorous fields for which you have been well prepared here. But we must make no mistake. Walking in wisdom and speaking with grace often involves taking a definitive and costly stand. There is a time to keep silent, but there's also a time to speak. While Daniel and his friends served the kings of their day as faithful servants, their allegiance was to God alone. When faced with the temptation to abandon scriptural teaching in order to avoid suffering, they took a stand. These moments of standing firm provide us with some of the most memorable passages in all of Scripture. For Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, walking in wisdom meant that under no circumstances would they bow down to an image or worship anyone or anything but God alone, speaking unequivocally. Our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O King. But if not, let it be known to you, O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image which you have set up. For Daniel, it meant that he repeatedly told the truth about God's judgment whenever given the opportunity, no matter how uncomfortable the circumstances. More than that, he prayed fervently, consistently, sometimes publicly, and exclusively to the God of his fathers, the Creator and Lord of heaven and earth. The words spoken by these brave pilgrims accompany the most beloved stories of the Old Testament, involving, as they do, enraged kings, fiery furnaces, and a den of lions. This kind of stand for truth is also part of what makes up a life in which one walks with wisdom toward outsiders, speaking with grace. Sometimes these stands will lead to the loss of position or to mockery. But friends, your Father in heaven, who sees even what is done in secret, will reward you. This brings us to another example which should be prominent in our minds this year, that of the larger-than-life figure of Martin Luther. As you know, this year, the year in which you are graduating from Reformation Bible College, marks the 500th anniversary of one of the key moments of the Protestant Reformation. Before we get there, we have to remember the context. It was in 1517 that Martin Luther posted 95 theses, starting points for a late medieval debate on the door of Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany. By 1518, within 1 year of posting these theses, we can see the key hallmarks of Luther's theology. When summoned to a formal debate by his Augustinian brothers in Heidelberg, Luther makes it clear that salvation cannot be achieved through the law or by human works. He states, "The law of God, the most salutary doctrine of life, cannot advance man on his way to righteousness, but rather hinders him." Similarly, he says this, "Much less can human works, which are done over and over again with the aid of natural precepts, so to speak, lead to that end." By this point in 1518, Luther was also beginning to speak with greater clarity on grace and faith in salvation as well. We have quotes like this, "He is not righteous who does much, but he who without work believes much in Christ." And again, "The law says, do this, and it is never done. Grace says, believe in this, and everything is already done." In fact, all of us, Luther realized, were products of God's loving kindness. In one of his most beautiful and theologically rich statements from 1518, Luther writes, "The love of God does not find but creates that which is pleasing to it. The love of man comes into being through that which is pleasing to it." By 1520, these clear and biblical insights had metastasized into serious polemical writings in which Luther addressed the corruption of the Roman Catholic Church, the sacramental system, the nature of justification. Luther had a clear vision of the truth of Scripture, and he took his stand. Like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Luther recognized that it was a time to speak and not to keep silent. The Pope, of course, had had enough of Luther by this point, and the emperor summoned Luther, then rescinded the summons, then summoned him again. At one point, while all of this was going on, Luther was asked what he might do if finally summoned to appear before the emperor. He responded, invoking those examples from Daniel. He said, "If Caesar calls me, God calls me. If violence is used, as well it may be, I commend my cause to God. He lives and reigns who saved the three youths from the fiery furnace of the king of Babylon. This is no time to think of safety. I must take care that the gospel is not brought into contempt by our fear to confess and seal our teaching with our blood. Luther did appear before the emperor, finally entering Worms on April 16th, 1521, 500 years and 22 days ago. It was a time of high tension. Crowds gathered in the streets upon his arrival. The next day, April 17th, 1521, Luther had to answer for the things he had written. He was examined by an official of the Archbishop of Trier, at the end of which Luther asked for a day to consider his answer to the withering accusations of heresy. He appeared early the following evening, April 18th, and there took his famous stand. The exact words are disputed, but there can be little doubt of the sentiments and conclusions that Luther ultimately conveyed. He is reputed to have spoken these words: "My conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. God help me. Amen." Early printed versions of the speech also include these words: "Here I stand. I cannot do otherwise." The denouement of this trial is worth noting on this day. It was on May 6th, 1521, exactly 500 years ago yesterday, that the Edict of Worms, the work of a secular council handling a heresy trial on behalf of the Pope, was issued. "Luther is to be regarded as a convicted heretic," it read. "When the time is up, no one is to harbor him. His followers are also to be condemned. His books are to be eradicated from the memory of man." Today, I suppose we could celebrate the 500th anniversary of the start of the post-Edict of Worms era, when the formal separation began. In reality, this edict was of no practical use in stopping the truth. Luther's conviction only gained him notoriety. He survived and continued writing. His followers increased. And for as long as there are places like Reformation Bible College, his books will surely not be eradicated from the memory of man. Sometimes walking with wisdom toward outsiders looks like that: taking a stand, being subject to conscience and to the word of God. Certainly, when the truths of God's word are at stake, we, like Luther, cannot do otherwise. The world of our day, like the world of Daniel's day, and the world of Luther's day, and the world of yesterday, and the world of tomorrow, has no sympathy for the fullness of God's word and its truths. Those outside of Christ want to stand in judgment on him and on everyone who seeks to serve him fully. By tethering your conscience to the word of God, you are, in some measure, setting yourself up for persecution and derision. Jesus Christ said to his followers, "If they hated me, they will hate you also." And the Apostle Paul writes, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." But then Paul goes on to say in the next verses, "You, however, continue in the things you have learned." I really don't think I need to tell you about the new Gnosticism today. It's in the air you breathe. I don't have to tell you that the teaching of Scripture about the creation of man as male and female in God's image is hated by some. The teaching that people of every race are made in God's image is hated by some. The clarity of scriptural teaching on marriage is hated by some. And that's just the first two chapters of the Bible. I don't need to remind you that the Bible's teaching about the fall of Adam and the corruption and guilt that Adam's sin brings upon all descended from him is ignored. I need not tell you that the commands of God are viewed in the popular imagination as restrictive and outmoded relics of an irrelevant age. Even the most unambiguous teaching of Christ, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father except through me, is simply cast aside and forgotten. We cannot underestimate the guile of the enemy of God's word. As Luther's great hymn reminds us, for still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. But you graduates have the opportunity to walk with wisdom and speak the truth with grace. You have the opportunity to live dedicated to the premise, as stated by Dr. Sproul, that the ultimate truth is the truth of God. When you walk and speak in this way toward outsiders, you declare to them in your lives that you live under the authority of that word above all earthly powers, which no thanks to them abideth. Living under this authority, we can confidently say, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still, his kingdom is forever. Class of 2021, I speak for everyone here in offering you our sincerest congratulations. We stand here committed to the Word of God and the truth of Christ. We know that this is a generation filled with challenge. It always has been so. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders. Speak with grace. Entrust your soul to your Creator. As you do, may Christ richly bless you. As those taught by Christ, surely we must say, here we stand. We cannot do otherwise. May it be so. Amen.
Please join us in singing our college hymn, Clothed in Righteousness, written by Reformation Bible College's first president, Dr. R.C. Sproul.
Thank you.
You may be seated. I was reminded that hymn reminded me of a moment years ago, 4 years, 5 years ago, with Dr. Sproul as we were waiting for commencement, and we were listening to the bagpiper, and he turned to me and he said, "Isn't it nice that we call them pipers and not bags?" How we all miss Dr. Sproul. I think if he were here, Dr. Master, he would be cheering you on. That was wonderful. Thank you. You've given us another day to celebrate. May 7, the first post-edict 500th celebration. I'm there. Thank you. That was quite a challenge for our graduates. We're grateful. We offer a few awards to recognize superior achievement among our graduates. First is the Biblical Studies Award, sponsored by Crossway. It consists of a $150 gift certificate for Crossway Books from their website at crossway.org, and the 2021 Biblical Studies Award goes to Catherine Upton. Catherine, please stand. Thank you. We will make sure you get that gift certificate. Second is the Theology Award, sponsored by the Banner of Truth Trust. It also consists of a $150 gift certificate for purchase of Banner books. You can purchase Dr. Master's new book, and you can find those at banneroftruth.org. The 2021 Theology Award goes to Nolan Sorello. Please stand. We have two foundation year awards. One of these is for our on-campus students and one for our online program. This award consists of a premium edition of the Reformation Study Bible. The on-campus award goes to Carissa King. And the Foundation Year Award from our online students goes to Brittany Reams. Brittany is in Idaho. I'm sure she's watching, so congratulations, Brittany. I'm going to break from the program for just a moment because I have an announcement. It's really my great pleasure to announce to you a promotion. And I can't think of a better place and time than here and now. Our very own and beloved Dr. Tweedale is no longer our dean. He is now vice president of academics. I told Dr. Tweedale one of two things is going to happen. Either one, we'll have to add 2 minutes to the run sheet for you all to get through your applause, or number two, the students will start chanting Tweedale, Tweedale. And I really thought you were going to there for a moment. We are very happy for you, for your family. We will now call you the Reverend Dr. VP John Tweedale. But you would be the first VP Tweedale to say enough about me. So let's get back to these graduates. Would you please come and present the candidates for their degrees?
Will the candidates for graduation please rise? Board of Directors, Dr. Nichols, on behalf of the faculty, I present to you the following candidates for graduation. These candidates have satisfactorily completed all the requirements for their certificates or degrees, and the faculty recommends that the certificates and degrees be conferred upon them. Students of Reformation Bible College, candidates for certificate in theology, Charity Dodsey Akua, in absentia, Christopher Scott Allen. Jacob Garland Bradley. John Ernest Consilient, in absentia. Robert Lewis Conter, in absentia. Emily Madison DeChico, in absentia. Shane Michael Essay. Caroline Marie Gervais. Joseph Anthony Gilbert. Emma Paige Hawkins Garrett, in absentia. Jessica Marie Hunstad, in absentia. Tanisha Renee Jackson, in absentia. Andrew Gary Joseph, in absentia. Carissa Donnell King. Lydia Joy Ledford, in absentia. Gabrielle Malgorzorda Lawrence. Claire McKenna, in absentia. Leslie Elise Montoya. Reed Scott Norenberg, in absentia. Maya Elizabeth O'Quinn. Good job. Annika Gosha O. Brittany Cherie Reams, in absentia. Christopher Aaron Rogers, in absentia. Isaac Daniel Wills. Tucker Coleman Witt, in absentia. Students of Reformation Bible College, candidates for Associate of Arts in Theology, Iva Jane Gundon. Augustus Cordell Tomlinson. Student of Reformation Bible College, candidate for Bachelor of Arts in Biblical and Theological Studies, Josue Andres Marizalde. Students of Reformation Bible College, candidates for Bachelor of Arts in Theology, Dylan Christopher Brock. Nolan Christopher Cerula. Alexander Paul Lowther. Joseph Isamu Sato. Students of Reformation Bible College, candidates for Bachelor of Arts in Theology, Christian Thought, Patience Faith Cox. Michael R. DeBoard Hall. Stephen Brian Seal. Madison Ray Vanderdusen. Student of Reformation Bible College, candidate for Bachelor of Arts in Theology, Biblical Studies, Catherine Victoria Upton.
Let us pray. Our Father, you are the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth and all that is in them. You are also our maker, and to you belongs all glory. You are the one living and true God, and you are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. You are also the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, our mediator, through whom and in whose name we come before your throne of grace. We praise you for the love you have shown us in Christ, giving your only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For on the cross he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. We thank you, Father. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to you by the death of your Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. We thank you that he is risen from the dead, has ascended into heaven, and has poured out the Holy Spirit, and that by your abundant grace, we now walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Father, we thank you for saving these graduates, for delivering them from the domain of darkness and transferring them to the kingdom of your beloved Son, in whom they and we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We thank you for consecrating them to yourself and for continuing to work in their lives. We thank you for the love for you and for your people that you have made so evident in their lives. We thank you for bringing them to RBC and for entrusting them to our care for this all too brief time. Thank you for the opportunity we have had to get to know them, to teach them, and to be taught by them. Thank you for sustaining them by your grace during their studies and for bringing them to this threshold in their lives. Father, as they leave RBC and move on to the next stage of their lives, may they never cease to love you with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength. May they always remain humble before you. May they never falter in their faithfulness to the Lord Jesus Christ. You will call them all to different vocations. In whatever sphere of life you call them to, may they shine as a light in this dark world. Through them, may multitudes come to know the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And on the last day, may they hear you say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Glorify yourself in and through the lives of these graduates. May they always rest in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Will the graduates please rise? Members of the Board of Directors, faculty, staff, parents, and honored guests, I present to you Reformation Bible College's graduating class of 2021. Thank you.
This concludes our 2021 commencement exercises. You are invited to join us for a light reception outside of Founders Hall.